Good morning. I would like to start with an administrational remark. There will be lecture notes on the course on partial hyperbolicity. It will be on the webpage. And there will also be notes about the renormalization course, but they are just handwritten, so don't expect too much. I think you can use the notes for the renormalization to recall the definitions, but it is handwritten. Okay, so let's begin. So we are. We are going to talk about renormalization in low-dimensional dynamics. And we would like to discuss renormalization in any dimension, but it will be very low. We will be discussing one- and two-dimensional dynamics. Okay, so what is this renormalization? We start from scratch, so don't worry. So what is renormalization? It's a very simple idea. And so you just take your dynamical system, and you have your map. This is our state space and our map. And then what you do is, you just choose some subset, and then you look at the first return map. So the renormalization of F is the first return map to, and this is a little tricky part, a well-chosen U part of X. And so what you do is you take a point X in U and you iterate it a couple of times and then it returns. And that is the how you define the renormalization. So you get the renormalization of our F will be a map from U to U. But then what's off, because you could take this U very tiny, so if you don't rescale it, you might not see anything. So you rescale also. You go back to sort of a unit size. And then here we see really our renormalization. So there is a rescaling involved. And just to get back to unit size. Okay, so you see this is a very simple idea. In the cases we understand, so in most of the situations we don't understand at all how this behaves, but in the cases we do understand, something nice happens. So renormalization unifies sort of the main aspects of dynamics. So if you here have renormalization, so if you do dynamics, you would also like to understand the topology of your original dynamical systems. And very often, in the cases we understand, renormalization allows us to give a topological description of the dynamics. This is vague, but we will see examples, and then this connection will become very precise. Another part which is closely related to is the geometry. And that is easier to understand. Because you see this renormalization, it takes like a ball on a small scale, and you see what happens. You blow up. And so renormalization is like a microscope. And a microscope is perfect to understand geometry. And so the first thing about the renormalization is really understanding geometry. So then there is another part. is measure theory. And so the existence of invariant of relevant invariant measures. And another part which is missing is bifurcations. So, and in the cases we understand, renormalization connects all these main branches of dynamics. And that is a nice aspect. And a little bit surprising that you can, that this very simple idea of using a microscope sort of starts to connect, you can easily say, the main branches of dynamics. Okay. So, we are going to discuss concrete examples, but let me clarify these connections a little bit. So let's say something about topology. Oops. So if you choose a piece where you're going to look in, a smaller piece, you associate to that a type of renormalization. And so there's what they call, there's topological information, it's a type of renormalization. The type. And that is combinatorial information. Combinatorial information. And for example, it could be that here you have our original system, and it could be that our set U and the return map to U is something very simple. It could be that the set U just goes to another set and then it returns. And so it means that the renormalization, here's the renormalization of F, and it is just the second iterate of the map restricted to this U.
Excuse me. Yeah. In the definition, you're assuming that the first iterate map is constant on all of U.
No. So, no. This is like the simplest case. U goes and it returns in one step and the whole thing. This is the simplest of the simplest situations. And in general, it will not be at all like that. In general, this return map will be something complicated. But you will see examples where this will turn out. So this picture illustrates that a renormalization has a type, and in this that is topological information that says that the renormalization is built in such a way that you take the piece, you map, and you come back. That's a specific type, and clearly that is combinatorial information. So and now in the cases we understand. So if F and G have the same type, a renormalization type, and later we will see precisely what that means, then F and G have topologically conjugated attractors. And so here we have our map F, and here we have our map G, and you can renormalize F, and it is a certain type, and you can renormalize G with the same type. So then there will be an attractor here of F, and there will be an attractor here of G. And then there will be a conjugation between the attractors. And so H of F is G of H. And so apparently, the renormalization type implies the topological structure of the attractor. And that is sort of the machinery how this works. If you know the renormalization types, you can figure out what is the topology of the attractor. And again, we will see concrete examples of how this works. So let's go to the geometry. Okay, so let's take again, so F and G have the same renormalization type. And then what happens is that if you start to take repeated renormalizations of F and you start to take the corresponding renormalizations of G, then in the C1 topology, this converges to zero. And so if you start, means what it means is that if you have your map F here and you have your map G, and you start to zoom in here, say this is U1, and here we have V1, and now we start to zoom in here U2, and we start to zoom in V2, and it continues like this, so you get a very tiny UN, and if you blow this up, you will see the nth renormalization of F, and you go very deep here, and you go to nth level, and you zoom out, you will see the nth renormalization of G, and then they are almost the same in the smooth topology. But that means that if you look in the geometry of what is living here, and the geometry of what is living here, these are parts of the attractor, so we are zooming in to a very tiny part here, and we are zooming to a very tiny part here in the corresponding place, then the pictures are the same. And so apparently, this convergence of renormalization implies a certain universality of geometry. Okay, so you get here, it's almost the same on small scale, it's universality of geometry. So this is sort of a key ingredient. And maybe not everywhere, but it is at least in the place where we zoomed in, we see that we see the same geometry. So it can be, so this universe, I should have written this larger because this is really a crucial aspect of renormalization. You see, convergence of renormalization gives you universality of geometry, but sometimes it goes even further. And so in the picture, we see we zoomed in on a very tiny scale here and a very tiny scale here, and the geometries are the same. So that means that this conjugation is differentiable in this point. So it might happen that it can be, there's a notion of rigidity, that this conjugation from the attractor of F to the attractor of G is differentiable. And so if you start to renormalize, if you have systems which you can renormalize, then sometimes it happens that the attractors, they get a universal geometry everywhere. And so these are crucial notions, universality and rigidity, when you're talking about renormalization. And we will see very concrete examples of this. So let's go to the measure theory. That is, so measure theory. So again, in the cases we understand the renormalization type, if you know the renormalization type, that will allow you to the construction of invariant measures of relevant invariant measures. I say new. And what we want to have is that if you start to average a function, then that converges to the integral with respect to the function. These are called physical measures. So very in the cases we understand, the physical measures can be constructed out of only knowing the renormalization types. And again, we will see examples. And so this connection is also there. And about the bifurcation pattern, that is sort of where everything began. If you have a question or if something is unclear, let me know and we can try to make it clear. So what happens is, so clearly our renormalization operator, what it does is it takes a system and it produces a new system. And so what renormalization is, it is sort of made to study the space of systems, because that's where the renormalization acts. So we have the space of systems. And renormalization acts on that space. You take a system, you zoom in, you get a new system. And in the cases we know, and in the very simplest cases, so you see another dynamical system here. A renormalization by itself is a dynamical system. And it is one of, in the cases we understand, it is one of the simplest ones, namely hyperbolic ones. And so what you very often see, of what you very often see, is this picture you see. The dynamics of renormalization has a fixed point, and it has some unstable manifold, and it will have some stable manifold. Yes, it's a hyperbolic picture, and the holy grail of renormalization is to prove this picture, hyperbolicity of renormalization. And then the key thing is that is, again, in the cases we know, stable manifold of this fixed point is the same as the topological class, as a topological class. And that means that if you know the renormalization types of your system, that will define the set of all systems with the same type. It's a topological class. And it turns out that has a manifold structure. And this is something which that's quite a result. Okay. So we discussed very briefly how the main questions of dynamics are related, are connected by renormalization. And in the cases we understand renormalization well, this picture is working fine. Okay. So the reason why this picture is working fine is that renormalization comes with so-called renormalization phenomena. And we mentioned already universality and rigidity. And these phenomena by itself, they are interesting and fascinating. And let me give you an example, a simple example of a simple and surprising example of this intrinsic renormalization phenomena. And I'm sure that you have all seen this. But let's speak about peer doubling. And let's first speak about a peer doubling bifurcation. And so what we have is we have a family. And what we can plot is we can plot the parameter. And what happens is at a certain parameter value, before that value, the dynamics is controlled by an attracting point. It's very like if you take this low parameter value, you look what you see here is something very simple, ft, and you just sitting somewhere. A fixed point, and everything converges here. This is like the simplest type of dynamics you can imagine. But now you change the parameter, and you get to the specific value t0, and then what happens is that this periodic point, this attracting, stops being attracting, and it becomes something different. It's still a fixed point, but not attracting anymore, and it splits into a peer 2 orbit. And so in this case, what you will see is if you look at this parameter and you look at the picture, there will be like two points which are exchanged and things will converge to this peer 2 attractor. So this is a peer doubling bifurcation. And I'm sure that you all have seen this picture in your first courses in dynamics. But then there is something, the peer doubling cascade. I'm sure you have seen this picture. It's sort of a famous picture. And so we have our family again. And what happens is that we start with our attracting point, and then there is a first moment where we see the attracting point bifurcate in the peer 2 attractor, and then there will be a little later, the peer 2 attractor will split into a peer 4 attractor. And then a little later, it will bifurcate by a peer doubling bifurcation in period 8. And that will continue like that. And there will be a limiting value. And very often, this is the boundary of chaos. And so if you push your parameter a little bit further, the system turns chaotic. And so this is the peer doubling cascade, and it is like the peer doubling route to chaos. This is the place where renormalization was introduced in dynamics. And we will get to more details about this, but not at this moment. So what happens is, and it has something to do with the bifurcation pattern. So if you have, and this is in the, this is real world, eh? So this is in the real world. So systems with this friction, then you, what you see is, hey, that you see all these pair doubling bifurcations, and they will converge to the boundary of chaos. And what you will see is that these bifurcation moments, they converge to the boundary of chaos, and they converge exponentially fast, and the rate is 1 over 4.669, something like that. And this is in the real world examples. So you can build electrical circuits, and if you turn the voltage up, then at some point it will create a pair doubling cascade, and it will turn chaotic. And then if you measure the parameters where you get the bifurcation, you see 4.6. People measure this. And there are tons of, in mechanical systems, with friction, and in electrical circuits, they even found something like this in fluid dynamics. This is a little bit more tricky, but so this is what they call parameter universality. And for obvious reasons, apparently these moments where you're bifurcating from pair doubling each time, that the rate doesn't depend at all whether you're looking at an electrical circuit or a mechanical thing or even a fluid dynamics. There is something universal in this parameter behavior. So, and this is this is surprising. This is surprising. And so apparently, you have this, the renormalization connects the typical questions we know in dynamics, but it gives itself new phenomena. There are intrinsic renormalization phenomena, like parameter universality, which is by itself a very interesting phenomenon. These are things you can actually measure, and people do measure this. Okay. Okay. We will come later to the history, more precise history of this fact. Okay. So let me show you the plan. So I apologize. So far we have been discussing like in a very informal, very sort of vague, blah blah story. I have no illusion about it. So you just have to let it come over you. But this is just phenomena. But we are going to make this more precise in examples. And we are going to make the list of all the examples we understand well. Most of the examples we don't understand, but we will discuss also all these phenomena, in particular this picture, with examples. And that is in what we are going to look at is, the first thing is we look and diffeomorphisms of the circle, and we are going to renormalize those things. We are going to look at unimodal maps, and those are maps, something like that. Three. We are going to look at Lorentz maps. And you know that it's like the butterfly. You know, how was that again? You know. Something, you know, the butterfly. And we are going to look finally at Hendel maps. Okay, so this is clearly one-dimensional. The dimension refers to the dimension of the underlying space. Unimodal is one-dimensional. So Lorentz is, you know, you can reduce this flow to a map on the interval. But it is a funny interval. So this is sort of 1.5 dimension. No, there's a serious reason. It's not a joke. Of course, but there's something going on here. So, and then, of course, Hendel maps is really 2D and even 3D and higher, but we concentrate to 2D. And this renormalization stuff, it is sort of difficult. And the difficulty is making this picture precise. This is where this is the heart of the matter, to prove hyperbolicity of renormalization. And it is something like that is the easiest. Renormalization of circle diffeomorphisms is the easiest one. A little bit more difficult is unimodal. And then Lorentz maps is still very difficult. And Hendel map is a little bit understood, but a little bit. And so the complexity sort of goes down. It's becoming more complicated when you go in this way. Circles are simple, unimodal more complex. You see. How are we doing with the time?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay. So let's start to discuss circle diffeomorphisms. It's the simplest case, but we will need 1 or 2 days to discuss this. So it's not that simple. And also, probably many of you have seen already the circle case. And so it's like the first example, but it is also to refresh a little bit your memory if you have seen it already. Okay, so let's do a circle diffeom. And so hopefully many of the blah, blah things will become more precise in this discussion. Of all the blah, blah should become precise in this discussion. So we are looking at maps from the circle, the interval to the interval, and they look like this. This is 0, this is 1. So somewhere is what they call the critical point. Point, and somewhere is the critical value, and it looks something like that. So you're looking at maps which are something like that. There is a branch here, and there is some branch here. And what we want is that F is piecewise smooth and monotone. So this piece is something smooth, and this piece is something smooth. So that's important. And then there is a little tricky thing, which makes it into a circle diffeomorphism. But you want this. Oh, I made the wrong picture. Sorry. So let's do this again. And somewhere here we have the critical point, and somewhere here we have the critical value, and we want the two branches to be separated by the critical point. So then the second property we need, that these branches should be a little bit related. We want that the derivative of f on the plus side of the critical point times the derivative in zero, which is this derivative, that should be the same as the derivative on the minus side times the derivative in the one. Yeah, it's really a circle. Yeah.
You're assuming it's a different morphism on the whole circle.
Yeah. And so if.
Why do you like this twice?
Yeah, because. So. So let me say it like this. If you start with circle diffeomorphisms, and then of course you have the circle and you cut open the circle and you get the interval, and then what you will see is that these branches and these branches they really sort of continue. It's a smooth thing, and this thing here and this thing here is really the same. So that are circle diffeomorphisms. But now, if you renormalize, and you will see the next step will be renormalization of such things. If you renormalize, it will not be like this anymore. It will not be anymore that this thing is just a continuation of the other side. There is sort of a knick. And so here there is a knick happening. And also there's a knick happening here. And so, and what we want is, we want to have a space of systems, and our renormalization acts on that space. So now you see, if you would be really working with circle diffeomorphisms, if you renormalize, it's not a circle diffeomorphism anymore. So we have to enlarge the space. And if you do this, if you use this definition, then that will introduce a space of systems which will be invariant under renormalization. That's a little tricky thing. not tricky, but that's what you have to do. And you will see why this happens. Okay, so yeah, this is like zero, and this is one. This is one. Oh, now you take the derivative here, and you multiply it times the derivative in one. I think it's correct. It's like this with that. And that is it. I think it's right. Let me introduce renormalization, and you will see why you need to do this. Okay. So renormalization. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
So it's not a circle.
No. And so we want to understand circle diffeomorphisms, so we are going to renormalize them, but the way we are going to renormalize will be such that if you take a circle diffeomorphism, it's not a circle diffeomorphism anymore. So and then we are lost, because then we cannot repeat the process. So we have to enlarge a little bit the space where we are living, and then this enlarged space of maps will become invariant under renormalization, and then we can start to talk about hyperbolicity. And the enlargement of the space is this. And clearly, if you have a diffeomorphism, it matches. So the diffeomorphisms are included here. Okay? So let me define the renormalization. There are two cases, yeah, unfortunately. So it can be that C is smaller than, you know, let me give some name. The space of these systems is called D. And if the C is smaller than V, we call it D minus. And then how do you renormalize that? So here we have C, and here we have V. And so here we have our map, something like that. And remember, when you renormalize, what we have to do is you have your space, and here we have F, and we have to choose a U. And then here we will look at the first determinant to define the renormalization. So how do we do this here? So, excuse me?
Are you assuming that this orientation
preserves? Yeah. Oh, sorry, yeah. Piecewise smooth, monotone, and orientation things, yeah. And like this picture. So the U we use in this case, our domain, that's called the domain of renormalization, is U, and it is just this interval. And so we are going to make a picture inside here. And so U is the interval 0, V. And now we need the first return map to that interval. Now you see that's easy. This part is already returning. So the first return map on the right is just the original map. It puts it back immediately. And on the right, on the left, you see, you have to do this, then you land here, but then you're back. So you will get something like this, and that is the second iterate. And now you rescale the bottom to unit size, and you get renormalization. That's how you renormalize. And that is in the case when C is smaller than V, and in the other case, I guess that means to stop, eh? Do you allow me to finish the definition and then tomorrow we...
No, you're
gentle, I understand. So the other case when C is larger than V, and we call it the V plus case. And we have a situation like that. Something like that, and we have something like that. And you can imagine what to do in this case. The U is the interval V bound. And so now we have to look at the first return map to in this little square. And now you see, it's going to be exactly the opposite. On the left side, you can just keep the branch, it's already returned. And on the right side, you see, you have to go outside, and then you're back. And so we will see something like the second iterate. It's very similar to this case, just flipped around. And so in that case, in that sense, we have our renormalization operator. We should stop today.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's continue tomorrow.